Honors. May it please the Court. My name is Steve Weiss. I represent Mario and Cecilia de la Fuente. The first matter I'd like to address, please the Court, is the denial of the amendment of counts 5 and 6 of the complaint, which charged excessive force. We needed to name somebody because there were civil rights counts. It turned out to be Sergeant Mark Doty. It also turned out that Sergeant Mark Doty was a mystery man. The city of Phoenix Police Department sergeant. The city of Phoenix disclosed a list of 180 plus police officers. He was not one of them.
But I thought you had deposition testimony that identified Sergeant Doty as the person who had called the SWAT team.
Well, once I started to do the depositions, what I'm saying is I get the disclosure.
Right.
And I'm looking to find out who this mystery man is.
I'm sorry, I didn't make my question very clear. I thought there was a delay of another 2.5 months or so before you formally moved to amend the rules.
Yeah, I can easily explain that.
Okay.
The first deposition I did was Sergeant Hilliger, and he was the leader of the SWAT team. And logically, I just thought he would know. Well, he didn't. So I decided, well, who's the next logical person? And that was Detective Garcia, who was the affiant on the search warrant, because the SWAT team was called in to help in the arrest and the search. And all he said to me was he didn't know, but he thinks it's this Doty. And quite frankly, we were under a very strict limit of depositions in this case. And I didn't want to waste a deposition based upon Garcia's speculation. I didn't, and if I did, the answer to the interrogatory would have come after I actually found out who it was, at least from Lieutenant Collins. I looked at it the other day.
I guess the issue for us is whether or not it was an abuse of discretion given the timing of the request, because we don't apply the Rule 15 liberality standards. We have to find that the district court concluded improperly that there was no good cause.
And I understand that. And when you look at the case that the defense cites, the Johnson case, it cites to a case called Forceman versus Culp. And what that case says is that once some good cause is shown, then the test is abuse of discretion. And so...
Well, I know that's a little bit begging the question, because the district court found lack of good cause due to lack of diligence. And I mean, that's a factual finding, is it not? Maybe it's a mixed question of law and fact, I'm not sure.
No.
And then we review that by the abuse of discretion.
Your Honor, I got the disclosure February 21, look to see what the money, February 21 with 240 pages of reports, and I had to go through that. If I was able to do that in 2 days and then send off an interrogatory, the interrogatory wouldn't be due until after I deposed Lieutenant Collins. And Lieutenant Collins was the second, he was the head of the investigation, and all he could do was speculate that it was Doty. But at that point...
Did you move to extend the discovery?
No, and I should have. I should have. And I understand that. But when you get right down to it and you take a look at what happened, once I got the name, I canvassed the defense, and they had no objection. And so I filed the motion. And the court came to the conclusion that the basic ruling was that there was a potential disruption of the litigation. But here's the situation.
Well, I mean, I know where you're going with the argument, but we have to be a little bit protective of our district judges and their prerogative in managing their calendar. And that's one of the reasons why we treat Rule 16 orders as orders that have teeth. Because he's got a crowded court calendar and he's trying to schedule trials, and at some point you got to call an end to discovery.
Right.
And you got to get this case either settled or tried.
And there was no more discovery to be done because we had already deposed Sergeant Doty. The count existed in the complaint, so there didn't need to be an amendment.
Well, let me go to harm here. As I understand your theory, the theory is it was what per se unconstitutional excessive force to employ a SWAT team to execute the warrant?
No.
So what's Sergeant Doty liable for?
Well, he enlisted a SWAT team.
Yeah.
The SWAT team comes in,
And the test is reasonableness, as I understand the case law, in terms of
SWAT resources.
Well, it's a Fourth Amendment test. Is using a SWAT team excessive under a Fourth Amendment standard of reasonableness? And I had experts, my expert opinion says it was absolutely uncalled for. And in fact, the reason they gave for employing a SWAT team, they gave four or three different reasons that they admitted were not true. And so they enlist this SWAT team. They act like SWAT teams do, but in this case, it was uncalled for. It really was. And so that's the essence.
The theory really is that it was excessive force to employ a SWAT team.
Yes.
That's your theory.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. Because they did what they did, and they did it well, but it wasn't deserved, and it was based upon false reasoning to even use them. As a matter of fact, and it's in the record, Detective Cornegay, who was the lead detective, I asked him about the SWAT team. He said he had no idea why they were called.
He was the supervisor who made that call, right? Was the sergeant who made it in charge?
Yeah, you know, I think Doty said he was, but you would think that Cornegate would have a knowledge as to why, and he just said it wasn't called for. So in the end. So that's my position there. It didn't disrupt anything. The litigation, the ebb and flow of the litigation would have gone on just the same. What we had to do is insert a name. And that was the basis and the sole basis for granting summary judgment.
Why didn't you base your argument on Rule 15?
I like to ask myself that. Really. I just did, and I thought it was 15. There was clearly, I think, an abuse of discretion. But like I said, when it's all said and done, when you look at the good cause test and you look at that case I cited that was actually cited by the defense, once there's good cause, and there was, then it's an abuse of discretion. Because frankly, as far as I'm concerned, there was no reason not to allow that amendment. None. So,
okay. The next thing I would like to address is the defamation counts. There were
actually three defamation counts. One at the conclusion or after the arrest, the city of Phoenix conducted, and actually in conjunction with the Attorney General, conducted a press conference, which interestingly, Lieutenant Holmes, I think he's lieutenant, who was sort of the moderator, characterized it as a dog and pony show. And so we had that. That was quickly followed by a website, which essentially echoed what was stated. And then we found...
I guess the question I had was, I looked at the video that you all marked as an exhibit and read the deposition testimony. How did what the city did here vary from what we see in almost every major criminal investigation that culminates in arrests and searches? I mean, you've got a grand jury returns an indictment. You've got multiple search warrants that are authorized by Maricopa County Superior Court judges, presumably on a finding of probable cause. And then arrests are made, the warrants are executed, and the officials call a press conference to tell the public what they're doing. How is this different from any other case, any other big investigation where they tell the public what they're doing?
Well, I think it differs because what they said about my client was just untrue.
But it was based upon a belief that there was probable cause for not only the issuance of the arrest warrants, but also for the execution of the search warrants, and why can't officers rely on the determination that there was probable cause in announcing the fact of the arrest and their allegations as to who was involved in the criminal enterprise?
Well, I think there is an obligation to take a look, see as to whether or not what you're saying about my client in terms of probable cause is true. For example,
I guess what we're really talking about here is what evidence do you have of stigma plus?
Okay.
Because clearly the calling of the press conference and publicly announcing the arrest of your client and the search of his home is under any other circumstances might be defamation, but in light of the Paul decision, the Supreme Court has said you got to have something more.
Here's what happened. Okay. Here's how it played out. In the disclosure statement, in anticipation of the stigma plus requirement, my client, there was a long narrative very detailed of his lost business opportunities, multi-million-dollar lost business opportunities. And when we went to deposition, I assumed he would be asked about that. Well, he wasn't on. As a matter of fact, in the city's brief, they referenced the fact that he was asked questions and he didn't respond. That was his wife, Cecilia, her deposition. So they never asked him anything about that. The only question they asked him was his net worth. So when the motion came in, the summary judgment motion came in, I didn't respond because it wasn't part of the record, anything about that stigma plus in terms of lost business opportunities.
Well, we have a motion to supplement.
Yes.
Before us.
Yes.
So normally our case law says we don't supplement with an additional evidence of that sort on appeal.
Well,
so why would we do that here?
Well, because I think what happened was the judge granted the summary judgment sui sponte on that argument, on that lack of business opportunity.
Well, why is it an error for the judge to do that if there's no evidence before him of that type of damage?
Well, had that issue been there, then I would have submitted an affidavit. It was there. The evidence is there. And I just assumed that the summary judgment would deal with the issues that were raised. And the issues that were raised were, they barely even talked about stigma plus. And so I talked about, well, there was defamation and there was a malicious prosecution. And so it just caught me by surprise. And I'm sitting on all of this evidence. I mean, I, at the deposition, I don't have the burden to ask my client questions to bring that to the fore. So
you've got the opportunity to submit whatever evidence you want from him. By way of declaration, you could ask him questions if you wanted to.
I could have.
So the issue is, why didn't you avail yourself of the opportunity to present evidence? And if you say you're surprised by the order, well, then you still have the opportunity to go back to the district judge and say, gee, judge, I didn't know that issue was on the table. Here's evidence. And was that done?
It was not. It was not.
All right.
Yeah, I'd like to save a little bit. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, my name is Dan Malinsky. I represent the Appalese, State of Arizona, and Campagnolo. I submit to you that the record is clear that Mr. Campagnolo only functioned in his official capacity as a prosecutor in this case, thus entitling him to absolute immunity. However, I would like to, at the outset, reserve 8 minutes of the Appalese time in order to allow Ms. Infrante to speak to you on behalf of her clients. As you know, the plaintiff's main argument, or if not one of their main arguments, is that Mr. Campagnolo was involved in a joint investigation with the police to thereby depriving him of the protections of absolute prosecutorial immunity. The plaintiffs cite to the Harper versus City of Los Angeles decision, which I think when you compare the facts in that case and contrast them with the facts in the case at bar, readily demonstrate that this was not a joint investigation. The court in Harper noted evidence from which a jury could conclude that the prosecutor did not independently exercise his duty. In fact, the district attorney himself testified in Harper that the police chief hounded him and his deputies to press charges and intentionally hampered the investigation. In contrast, the case agent, Detective Cornegay, brought his findings to Mr. Campagnolo, and after reviewing the statutes and evidence that Cornegay and the police brought to him, Mr. Campagnolo agreed to file charges. But in doing so, it's important to note that Mr. Campagnolo rejected some of the charges that Detective Cornegay had proposed. I think this helps to demonstrate that, in fact, Mr. Campagnolo was exercising independent judgment and as a prosecutor.
How about the counsel argues about Campagnolo asks Mr. Cornegay for legal citations as to why the why there was a violation of, I guess it was the moving vehicle. Doesn't that sound like the police are directing the course of the prosecution?
Not at all, Your Honor. I submit that what Campagnolo was doing was asking about a relatively obscure area of the law, liquor licensing and control, which is something that not every prosecutor has much experience with. And the officer provided the requested statutes or regulations, or at least ones that he thought were applicable, and submitted those to Campagnolo. Campagnolo then exercised his own independent prosecutorial analysis and in determining whether or not those even applied. Now, he determined they did, but I point out that this happened a year after the indictment was handed down. Moreover, as the district court correctly noted, Campagnolo, using these citations provided by Detective Cornegay, prepared a response or reply brief that clearly falls within the scope of what a prosecutor is supposed to do, as reflected in the Van de Kamp decision. So, Your Honor, I do believe that, again, in no time did Campagnolo step outside of his proper role as an independent prosecutor. I'd like to point this court to language cited with approval in the Imbler versus Pachtman decision, which I think is extremely apropos in this particular case. In Imbler, our Supreme Court cited language from an earlier decision with approval. And here's what the court said. The office of public prosecutor is one which must be administered with courage and independence. Yet how can this be if the prosecutor is made subject to suit by those whom he accuses and fails to convict? To allow this would open the way for unlimited harassment and embarrassment of the most conscientious officials by those who would profit thereby. There would be involved in every case the possible consequences of a failure to obtain a conviction. There would always be a question of possible civil action in case the prosecutor saw fit to move for dismissal of the case. That is almost entirely on point with the facts before you, Your Honor. I submit that Mr. Campagnolo is entitled to absolute prosecutorial immunity. That also will result in the immunity of the state of Arizona in connection with the state law claim for malicious prosecution brought in this case. Do you have any questions for me, Your Honors?
Nothing, thank you.
I will defer to Mr. Frati. Thank you, Your Honors.
Good morning. May it please the court. My name is Michelle Iafrate. I represent what we call the City of Phoenix defendants. It's Detective Cornegay, Chief Harris, Lieutenant Collins, Public Information Officer Holmes, Detective Garcia, and Public Information Officer Lana Laker. I just want to touch quickly on the malicious prosecution before I turn to the response to the appellant. The malicious prosecution claims, the plaintiff argues that there was some sort of joint investigation and that there were pressure to charge additional charges. And what the court found was that, first of all, there was a grand jury indictment. There was also an independent decision by the prosecutor in order to charge what charges to be made. Under Smitty, that immunizes my clients from any sort of liability. Also, it should be pointed out that there were some email exchanges, a handful of email exchanges between the prosecutor and the City of Phoenix. Those dealt not with charges as they relate to Mr. Manriquez, but to the co-defendants and the exchange of information as it relates to them. This is not like Harper, where there was daily activity, daily communication, daily pressure.
Could I turn to the defamation claim? Your clients are the defendants in that as well.
Yes.
So opposing counsel was focusing on the second prong, I guess, of the stigma plus about injury to reputation that caused deprivation of a property interest. But there's also the injury to reputation connection with the violation of a federally protected right. So defamation connection with an unlawful arrest. And so my question was, apparently the defendant's, the grand jury indictment was dismissed on a substantive due process grounds. Does that detract from finding probable cause for both the grand jury and I guess the state court judge may find these probable cause in making the arrest unlawful? Can you explain that? It wasn't explained in the briefs.
So, Your Honor, you touched on it just in your question. There was an arrest warrant based on probable cause, and because there was probable cause for the arrest and the city of Phoenix believed that there was probable cause for the arrest, that immunizes them from liability.
I'm sorry, was the arrest warrant based on the fact of the grand jury indictment, or was there a separate affidavit in support of an arrest warrant? How does state practice differ from federal charging practice?
Your Honor, I know that there were search warrant affidavits and also applications for arrest warrants that are separate.
I understand that, but let me explain the basis for my question. We are more familiar with the criminal procedure involving federal indictments, and U.S. attorneys frequently obtain an arrest warrant solely on the basis that the grand jury has made the probable cause determination, and an arrest warrant is therefore issued as a matter of course at the request of the prosecutor based solely on the fact of the indictment. There's no need for an independent judicial officer to make that determination until the defendant is, to make that determination.
I don't want to misstate the record. My remembrance is that there were applications both for search warrants and for arrest warrants above and beyond the grand jury indictment.
Which were presented to Maricopa County Superior Court.
Correct.
Okay. So we had a judicial officer determining probable cause for the issuance of the arrest.
That is correct. So going back to the two prongs for Paul versus Davis, no stigma plus, what the district court found in this case was that the information that was presented, not only to the press conference, the website, and the last 24, was that the statements that were made were actually truthful. For example, Detective Cornegay, nor any of his colleagues, said that the Manriquez money was illegitimately raised. He actually stated in the press conference that statement that he believed to be true, that no, there's no evidence that the Manriquez money was illegitimate in any way, but it was funding this fraud conspiracy. What you heard in the press conference, the website, and the last 24 is that there was an investigation, which is true, that search warrants and arrests were made, which is true, that there was an indictment, that the properties and the businesses were run by NAS, who we're calling NAS de Bregorcian, which is true, that this scheme was funded by Mr. Manriquez, which is true, and that ultimately the plaintiffs themselves admit that Mr. de Bregorcian, NAS, did indeed commit crimes that were alleged within the press conference, the website, in the last 24.
Does it matter that all the other co-defendants were convicted and subsequently at trial? Is that relevant at all?
It does not. At the time that the statements were made is how you determine whether they were truthful or not. And so the fact of what happened in the future does not somehow retroactively apply to the statements that were made at the time.
To get back to Judge Bakuda's question, as I understand what happened here, the state superior court judge dismissed the indictment on a procedural, a substantive due process violation that the defendant had what, a right to present exculpatory evidence to the grand jury?
The grand jury indictment was remanded, and so then the prosecutor, independently makes a decision whether to go back to the grand jury again to, again, indict.
Right, and at that point the accountant had died.
Correct.
And so the major witness against Mr. Mariquin was no longer available.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, one of the major witnesses, and it was the prosecutor's decision, obviously not the city of Phoenix's decision, regarding whether they could even proceed to the grand jury.
So they simply didn't represent the charges against Mr. Mariquin to the grand jury.
That is correct.
Okay. Or Mr. Manriquez, I'm sorry. Anyway,
I knew he
was.
I knew he was. Mr. Manriquez.
Yeah.
So if you do not have any further questions regarding defamation, I can quickly turn to counts 5 and 6 and regarding what standard to be used. The district court did the analysis within their order granting the motion for summary judgment that indeed Rule 16, not Rule 15, should apply in this case. And the appellant and the plaintiff down below did not show good cause why there should be a fourth crack at this. The original complaint was filed in September 2011. Judge Tallman, you asked, why didn't you do an interrogatory? I mean, throughout that entire period of time, there could have been an interrogatory. I can tell you that Garcia, Collins, and Cornegay each state that Doty was the one, not that employed the SWAT team, but asked Pima County for help. There were multiple search warrants going out at the same time. City of Phoenix did not have the manpower to do all of those search warrants. They went out to different agencies, which is common. DPS was involved, City of Phoenix, Pima County, a couple other task force were involved to execute these search warrants. And the execution of the search warrant was done by Pima SWAT team, and there is no contention anywhere, their expert, our expert, any expert, that what they did was inappropriate. They treated these people professionally. They did not cause further damage than necessary. No one was injured. That goes to the injury of Judge Tallman.
Well, that's why I questioned Mr. Weiss, because frankly, I was a little bit puzzled as to the plaintiff's theory of liability. I mean, the mere fact that they called the SWAT team doesn't sound like a constitutional violation to me.
I believe, and I don't want to misspeak for the appellant, but I believe that they were offended by the mere presence of the SWAT team.
Sort of a psychological injury.
Correct. That's
opposed to physical harm.
That's my understanding, because no one was physically harmed, and you saw in my brief that actually Mrs. Manriquez was treated very professionally and allowed certain graces because of her condition at the time. If you have any further questions, I will answer them.
I think not.
Okay, thank you.
Your Honors, pardon the randomness of this.
Rebuttal is like that.
Yeah, there was just so many things.
What you want.
So many things said. Just most recently about the SWAT. Using SWAT in and of itself is not a violation, but if in fact when SWAT does what it's supposed to do and that's unreasonable under the circumstances, it does.
And you've got an expert who would have testified that the manner in which the SWAT team carried out its duties that day at your client's home was unnecessarily.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Mr. Van Blair comes. Yeah, Mr. Van Blair comes in.
Yeah.
I just want to say something.
Chief of Police from Bellevue, Washington.
Yes.
I know
wow.
Him.
You know him?
I know him well.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
The other thing that was just mentioned was, you know, you yourself, Judge Tallman mentioned, when the accountant died, and that's why the accountant wasn't really going to be witness that was going to help the defense.
Well, no, but I guess the question that I think Judge Acuto properly was asking was, what does that do to the determination of probable cause? And as I understand the procedural posture of the case, it doesn't necessarily mean there wasn't probable cause for the issuance of the indictment. It means that it was unfairly obtained because you didn't have an opportunity to present exculpatory evidence that may have persuaded the
I don't think that's true. In Arizona, the basis to go and seek a remand is when there's a denial of substantial procedural due process.
And what was it in this case?
Well, it was because there was no basis to support. The core of the case, and they admitted, was that Mario De La Fuente did not disclose himself to the Department of Liquor License Control or the Motor Vehicle Department. That was the core. And the legal basis, the fight at the grand jury, the remand motion, was did he have a legal obligation to do that? And that's exactly why.
I understand your point. I thought the theory of the state's prosecution was that the silent investor was hidden from state authorities because there is a requirement in the regulations that the investor be disclosed. The question is, who has the obligation to make the disclosure? Isn't that?
Well, that's part of it. There is that question. Whose obligation is it? And I submit, and I think the statute says that it's the applicant. But the reliance on that regulation is really totally unfounded, and that's what happened. Because the regulation that they cite, and there's a case right on the money, Landon v. Stroud. And that case says that the regulation, which I have the number here, R1-302-19, something like that. It's cited in the excerpt. That regulation on this face would make it seem like somebody who was lending money or had an interest in the license has an obligation. But the Landon v. Stroud case clarified that and said, look, here's what this is. If you have an interest in a license and your concern is that when something comes amiss with this license, you want to be heard, then you have an obligation to notify the department that you have an interest in that license, and that's all it is. And in fact, there's in that opinion, there's an affidavit from the director of the liquor license board saying just that, and also saying it's not intended for investigative purposes. So the remand was
put behind the law. It says the liquor board wants to know who the true owners are who are executing their rights under the liquor license, right?
Well, in terms of that obligation to notify the liquor board that you have an interest, which he didn't have an interest in that license.
I mean, it's kind of like the same thing that the state of Nevada goes through when they issue gaming licenses. We want to know who we're really issuing the license.
Well, exactly. But Mr. De La Fuente did not have that obligation. And that was why the remand was granted.
Okay.
That's why.
I understand the answer to the question.
Yeah.
You have run over your rebuttal time by about a minute and a half.
I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you very much, counsel. The case just started.